which is directed into the sea, push salt water back into the sea, pushes salt water back into the sea. Because if we want fresh water reaching the sea, and this is what we, it's not a matter that we want it, it's nature, physics, that brings fresh water at a lower altitude, at the expense of its energy, to finally reach the sea, because we know that this is a natural water cycle. Rain falling over the mountains, over higher elevation, travels towards the sea, and the travel may be over the surface, and may be under the surface. And therefore, this energy of fresh water pushes the salt water back into the sea. So there is a kind of conflict, of encounter between, close to the sea, between fresh water and salt water. There is an interplay. And of course, this interplay is seasonally varying. It's a dynamic interplay. So you may have a season in which you have less fresh water coming from the land, and then the salt water gets in. And then you have the rainy season, more energy from fresh water, and the salt water goes back. It is extremely important to study this equilibrium. Why it's extremely important? Because salt water is salted, and being salted, it's a problem. You cannot drink it, and even more concerning, vegetation is affected by it. Vegetation doesn't tolerate salt, as we know. Or it may tolerate it somehow, but increasing salinity creates a damage, a substantial damage to ecosystems. And even more concerning is the fact that once a soil has been contaminated by salt, it's not easy to get it clean. So it's not just a matter of pushing the salt water back. The salt remains into the soil, and therefore even the salinity of the fresh water, even if it doesn't come from the ocean, increases. So this interplay is something that we have to study. Of course, there is an equilibrium situation, which may change in time because the sea level may rise, and in this case, an increase in 10 centimeters may be indeed a concern, not for being flooded, not for erosion, but for an increase of salinity in fresh water. So this is what we need to study, and we need to study this equilibrium, and in order to study a physical process, we have to understand it first in a qualitative way, and then quantitatively. Okay, still the conversation is not good. If we want to build a model, we have to write equation in a quantitative form that describes the process. But before doing that, we have to understand it qualitatively. Okay? So, what are the drivers? These are drivers in, look at the temporal scale and spatial scale. There are several drivers. I have two graphs to show you. This refers to regional to global scale. Then, in terms of spatial scales, you see regional to global. Then, I will show you another graph looking at smaller spatial scales. So these are drivers that are typically not local. They insist on a regional to global scale. Okay, so of course, let's try to understand these drivers, because it's extremely important. There are climate oscillations, and also look at the time scale. So 1 year and 10,000 years. Climate oscillations, look at the time scale and the temporal scale. And climate change, sea level rise, climate oscillations. What's the difference between climate oscillation and climate change? This is a very good question. Because we still don't know whether the climate tends to oscillate rather than changing irreversibly. And this is a huge debate, because think of global warming. If global warming is human-induced, anthropogenic, then it may be something that is irreversible, something that is unprecedented, so it's concerning. if global warming is due instead to a climatic oscillation, because we know that we had glaciation in the past, we had a period where the Earth was much warmer than today, and therefore it could be just an up and down. If it is an up and down, our solutions are different. If we need to devise, to design solutions to mitigate global warming or to mitigate the impact of global warming, the solutions are different depending on the drivers. If the driver is a climatic oscillation, the solution is different with respect to a driver that is increasing forever. And this is something that is not easy. There are millions of scientific contributions trying to understand what is the amount of natural variability in climate with respect to the amount of anthropogenic effect. Because indeed there is an anthropogenic effect, but is it prevailing on natural variability, or is natural variability prevailing? These are kind of questions that if you bring them up in a scientific conference, you get into a very vivid debate. And let me say vivid, not to say very nasty. It's very delicate. So, climate oscillation, climate change, and I would say that I'm not sure why they placed climate change in that position, which means a temporal scale that is higher. I don't think we can really make a difference there, because we don't know this phenomenon. Climate oscillations, we don't know them. Okay, subsidence, uplift. So, of course, if you have the land that is moving up and down, and the land is moving indeed up and down, because subsidence is important. It's like 30, 40 centimeters in the past 50 years in this area. And I'm not sure if, I give you an order of magnitude, don't take me literally, but I'm sure that it's something of the order of magnitude of tens of centimeters. So it's important. You may have tectonic uplift in some regions, after earthquakes, we assisted at a significant uplift of the land. Drought, I explain you later why drought are effective on saltwater intrusion, but you can already understand, because I told you that fresh water, the flow of fresh water from the land, is a significant driver. It's a significant agent that prevents saltwater intrusion. If you have a drought, which may imply reduced rainfall, may, because not all the droughts are originated by reduced rainfall, but if you have less rainfall, of course, you have a decrease of the fluxes of fresh water from the land to the ocean, and you may get saltwater intrusion. Hurricanes, and keep in mind that one of the most relevant consequences of the hurricane that occurred in Sri Lanka in 2006, if I well remember, was saltwater intrusion. They got all the wells contaminated by saltwater, and this is a relevant problem, still is. And they tried soon afterwards to recover the soil, but it was really tough. And they tried to recover the soil by injecting water into the soil, fresh water, in order to try to wash it out. But it is problematic. And the tsunamis, it was a tsunami, in Sri Lanka it was a tsunami in 2006, not an hurricane, sorry for the confusion. Okay, let's look at the other picture. These are, look at the scale, local, 1 kilometer square, regional. And at the local scale, you have drivers that are more related to anthropogenic activity. The connection is more evident, like accelerated subsidence, accelerated by what? By withdrawal of oil and gas from the subsurface, or water withdrawal. And then there is groundwater abstraction. This is an extremely important driver of saltwater intrusion. If you, we will discuss on this more in the next couple of hours. If you extract water from the underground, of course, you decrease the water flow from the land to the sea, and therefore you have salt water intrusion. This is something that is really concerning in this region, in Ravenna. They are much concerned by salt water intrusion induced by groundwater extraction. River modification, because of course if you change the shape and geometry of a river, or you move a river, because we do this also in the past, we did before river was moved, the delta was moved because Venice was concerned by the delivery of sand towards the lagoon, so they move the river. If you move a river, of course, you move the dynamics, you change the dynamics of the underground aquifers of groundwater. Land use change, of course, if you urbanize a region, you decrease infiltration. If you decrease infiltration, there is less water, fresh water flow. And land drainage, same thing, exacerbated climate change, exacerbated, what does it mean? At local scale, climate change can be indeed exacerbated by, for instance, the heat island effect. So in the cities, it has been proved that the temperature increased much more than in the overall land. And therefore, if you have increased the temperature in the urbanized areas, it affects also salt water intrusion. Okay. Here you see another picture, which again, I think it is nice, and again, emphasizes the drivers. The upper picture is understood the situation. In the understood situation, typically you don't have any extraction of groundwater. You have water everywhere, and also fresh water comes to the sea in a not organized way. Today we try to organize the drainage network in order to recover the land for our purposes, agriculture, whatever. And if we organize the river network, basically we change the interface between fresh water and salt water. And typically this interface is reduced in area, because we try to reduce the area of the wetlands. And if we reduce the area of the wetlands, then also the area of the interface between salt water and fresh water is reduced. In general, keep in mind that reducing the size of rivers or reducing the length of rivers causes an environmental degradation, because a relevant example is, for instance, the rivers that were rectified, straightened, in order to recover land. And a relevant example in Italy is the Adige River, and then the ecosystem got destroyed, because, you know, water needs room, the ecosystem needs room in order to reach their equilibrium, their natural equilibrium. If you reduce the room of rivers, then the ecosystems get disturbed. And a scientific technical explanation of the effect of the volume of water on the ecosystem can be given by simply saying that if you have pollutants released into a river, dilution of the pollutants is more effective if you have a lot of water, a lot of volume. If you dilute the same pollutants into a river that is one-tenth of its original volume, you get a concentration of pollutants that is 10 times the original one. And this is what happened in several rivers in Italy. In Italy, but also everywhere. Because it was a common practice to rectify rivers in order to gain land. Now we realize that it's not a good idea. And in some cases, we try to restore rivers to their original configuration. So basically here, what do you see? You see wells taking water from the underground, and therefore you see that the level of the water table is the interface between saturated groundwater zone and unsaturated zone. It's the level of water in the underground. So you see the water table that is at a lower level here. And as an effect, you see the salt water entering into the land in a much higher solution, in a much higher concentration and distance with respect to the top graph. And look at this wedge shape. I'll explain you later why salt water intrusion occurs according to a wedge, I'm not sure if my pronunciation is correct, shape. It's cuneo Italian, so it's something like that. We will see why. So if you have the land and the sea here, salt water intrusion occurs according to this shape. And this is the wedge. This is what you see here. We will see why we get this shape. Okay, I propose that we stop here for 15 minutes. I get coffee and I leave this graph on the screen for you. And it's ongoing, so I'm not sure it's clear, but I'll explain to you later on.